And let's give the Lord Jesus a wonderful round of applause. Today we are here in the name of Jesus, in His presence, with His presence, in His power, with His power. And today we're going to talk a little bit about resting in the Lord Jesus. The Bible tells us there is God's hiding place. It's in the beginning of Psalm 91. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High, wherever He is present, shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. When you don't dwell in the secret place of the Most High, you live agitated, upset, nervous, with problems here and there. And when you learn a little bit about resting with the Lord, to assume what is yours, in a short time you realize that things have changed. Now it's different. Now I have peace. A preacher once called my attention by saying the following: a family has 5 kids and none of them know Jesus. Well, check to see how is the children's behavior. Go and preach. And then they accept Jesus. And after 5 more children are born, go and observe the behavior of the new ones. It's different from the first ones, even though the earlier ones also accepted Jesus. People that are born where the gospel is already being read, these people are born with peace and tranquility. They're born resting in the shadow of the Almighty. God's word tells us this. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High, it's not an occasional visit, they live there. This person shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. In the book of Hebrews, chapter 10, verse number 12 reads like this: But this man, referring to Jesus, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, sat down at the right hand of God. Jesus had work to do, a very important work to do, and nobody could ever replace him. There wasn't even one righteous person. The choice fell on the divinity itself that is formed by 3 people, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. It fell on the Son, and the Son came, and we know the story, how He came, how He was born. Here He worked, and He worked an awful lot. He was a man of sorrows. His biggest work of all was when He substituted us, receiving in Him all of our illnesses and diseases. By fulfilling God's word completely, before He died, He cried on the cross, "It's finished." The work was finished. And now where is Jesus? Forever sat down at the right hand of God. Forever. And if we're in Jesus, as the Bible says, we're also seated there. But this man, after he had offered one sacrifice for sins forever, it's not necessary to ever offer a sacrifice again. He offered the only one that was necessary. And having done that, you know, for sins, all sins, mine, yours, and for everyone, forever sat down at the right hand of God. Of course, He will come back one day and take us to heaven if we are in Him, if we're in this position of winners. He's at the right hand of God, and we're at the right hand of God. But of course, if we work and pray and preach and so on, but we are in God's resting place, where the enemy, even if he tries over and over, you know, even if he tries to beat us, he won't be able to do that. Christians don't have to fight to overcome the devil. We've already overcome him because Jesus died for us. Jesus overcame the devil for us, and the victory that he accomplished with his death has been credited to our account. So, Dr. Suarez, pray for me because I'm fighting the devil and I'm going to win. Stop right there. Jesus has already overcome, and so have you. You just have to send the evil away, seek God's presence, and receive what God has in store for you. And God can and wants and will bless you. Today it's going to be a day of blessing here in the name of the Lord Jesus. You can be certain. This is what God's word says. He did one single sacrifice for our sins. There is no other. But what if I happen to sin again? You just confess to God and ask for forgiveness. But isn't Jesus suffering for me? No, He's already suffered what He had to suffer. Today, any person, no matter where they're from any race or any language, any size mountain of sins that they carry on their back, who listens to God's word and believes and says, God, forgive me, the person is forgiven. God takes all of that and throws it into the sea of forgetfulness. It will never, ever come back. And the person can live in the presence of God. From now on, the victory is mine. And when the devil comes, it's too late. I belong to Jesus. It's over. I am living with the one that is at the right hand of God. And don't fight to beat the devil. You know, you already did in the name of the Lord Jesus. Amen? It's what God's word says, because we have to believe. Yeah, but, well, that church or this Grace of God church says differently. Nobody can say anything against God's word. No preacher or no wise man. Nobody can ever say it's not like that. Everything that is written here that you saw and you read, listened to the sermon and understood, that's the truth in your life. Take it, because God is there with you. In your work, on your trip, in your house, no matter where you may be, with God's word in your heart, take God's presence with you. Don't let the devil bother you, because he's going to try, you know, to keep on tempting you so that you can say, now what do I do? Keep on believing. You're with Christ. And if you're not here today, take a step and live powerfully and abundantly with our Lord God. Listen, at one of the services here, these four people were healed. One of them was very beautiful, because she had a problem in her shoulders ligaments. And the moment that she was healed, according to her, there was a snap, and three ladies heard it. One of them behind her and the other two right there, they heard the snap. I don't know why God does these things when someone hears it, but normally he heals and nobody realizes it. But sometimes it's a sign for someone that needed to participate as well indirectly of this blessing, because tomorrow when this person is in need, they will remember. Now, I want to talk to you about resting, about having peace, going in peace, which is what God wants for us. Jesus was once invited to go to someone's house, and there's something very different happened, and this person received their blessing. It's in Luke chapter 7, starting with verse number 36. And what God registered here is for us to understand whatever you understand, he is talking to you. And you have to believe, folks. You shouldn't believe in just anything, but in the voice that God is revealing to you deep inside your heart. So now let's read from Luke 7, verse 36. Then one of the Pharisees asked him to eat with him, and he went to the Pharisee's house and sat down to eat. This is a serious matter, you see, because the Pharisees didn't like Jesus. And one Pharisee asks him, you know, could you give me the pleasure of coming over to my house? Because I've prepared some food, a lunch or dinner, a snack, you know. And Jesus said, I'll go with you. And the creator of heaven and earth enters the house of this Pharisee and sits down to eat with him. And then, you know, while the food was being served, it is written, and behold, a woman in the city who was a sinner, you know what she was, right? When she knew that Jesus sat at the table in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of fragrant oil. She heard that he was at the table in the Pharisee's house. Pharisees were the kind of people that, you know, there were some sects in Judaism, the Sadducees, the Pharisees, the scribes, they were groups. And these Pharisees considered themselves the best ones. They didn't speak to foreigners. When they arrived home, if they met someone, they would wash their hands and everything that was there. They were very strict in their daily lives and doctrine. And the woman learned that he was at the Pharisee's house, this man who was unsociable with anyone who was in sin. But the Holy Spirit ordered her to go. It's very important when you are listening to Jesus, like now, what you feel deep inside your heart, because this time God may solve your problem. So she found out and went there. Continuing reading now. She brought an alabaster flask of fragrant oil and stood at his feet behind him weeping. Nobody can handle Jesus' presence. I've already cried a lot at church, preaching that beautiful and holy presence comes, and at that moment you solve a lot of issues. One time we had a meeting downtown and we solved the problems of nations. God was present in that place on that Sunday morning in that church we used to have there. And stood at his feet behind him weeping. And she began to wash his feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head. And she kissed his feet and anointed them with the fragrant oil. Oh, what a beautiful thing. Imagine this picture. Now, when the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he spoke to himself, saying, "This man, if he were a prophet, would know who and what manner of woman this is who is touching him, for she is a sinner." He didn't know that Jesus wasn't just a prophet. Jesus was the one that anointed the prophets. He knew everything. He was God, omniscient. The prophet knows when God reveals. God knows because he knows. Nothing can be hidden from God. And the Pharisee didn't realize that who was there was the eternal God, like sometimes we don't realize and we miss our blessings. And Jesus answered and said to him, "Simon, I have something to say to you." So he said, "Teacher, say it." He was really a Pharisee. He was calling Jesus a teacher and he was judging him at the same time. He was so wrong. So with wisdom, Jesus said, "There was a certain creditor who had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii and the other 50. And when they had nothing with which to repay, he freely forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them will love me more?" Simon answered and said, "I suppose the one whom he forgave more." And he said to him, "You have rightly judged." Then he turned to the woman and said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has washed my feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head. You gave me no kiss, but this woman has not ceased to kiss my feet since the time I came in. You did not anoint my head with oil, but this woman has anointed my feet with fragrant oil. Therefore I say to you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But to whom little is forgiven, the same loves little." So pay attention. If you love God completely, with all of your heart, no, you need to be forgiven completely. It's not that you have a few sins or the other person has less. God forgives in the proportion that we do His will. When He touches our heart, in my heart, in your heart, if we have any sins, our sins won't be forgiven completely. We have to open our heart to God. And if the sin also includes a person whom we've offended, we have to look for this person and set things right with them. Otherwise, we won't be forgiven. The Pharisee did something. He invited Jesus. He wanted just a little bit, so a little is forgiven. But she was different. She wanted everything. She wanted to be born again. She wanted to have her life changed. And so she was there contrite, crying at the feet of Jesus. So Jesus then said, "Therefore I say to you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven." She was a sinner. She must have sinned an awful lot, but every one of her sins was forgiven. But to whom little is forgiven, the same loves little. Then he said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." Do you think that only this woman had the privilege to hear Jesus saying that? No, no. This is very important, brethren. The point is, we need to seek a more intimate relationship with the Lord. How, Dr. Suarez? By reading the Bible, meditating, and praying. We don't have to pray only to be healed from a headache or to solve a problem. We have to seek God. Our soul needs to find Him. And at a time like this, He will make a statement to us. And this will guide us through our entire lives. "Woman, your sins have now been forgiven." It's over, woman. You're no longer at the devil's hands. You've been rescued from the bird's cage. You're now free. You are free from sin for the rest of your life. There is no more sin for you anymore. Now you're free. You're going to heaven, going to eternity with me. Seek this moment. But does he speak? Yes, he does. Listen, the day you have a deep experience with God, you'll never be the same person again. You'll change, people. Your life's goals will change completely. Your desires will change. Your reaction to any offer the devil offers you will become completely null to you and count as a victory for Jesus. I can't do it, Dr. Suarez. You're going to have this feeling. The devil can't touch you. You're going to be your own master. And she got this decree from the hand of the Creator of heavens and earth. And he said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." And those who sat at the table with him began to say to themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sins? How can this be?" And Jesus went further. He said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." This is another word that you need. Nevermore will the devil that used to make you sell your body and make you sin dominate you and your life. Now you are going to be a woman who is respectful. You're going to be an example. The mundane and sinful life is over. And now you're a holy woman of God. Go in peace. Your faith has saved you. There is nothing else in the world that God can do in your life that is greater than your salvation. When he stretches out his hand and says, "This is mine," the devil respects this decree, because the word that he gave you will never leave your life. And when the devil arrives, this word is a consuming fire. He's going to get burnt. You will never, ever lose again. And when the last trumpet plays and he comes in the clouds in the twinkling of an eye, and God will separate humanity, because it's going to happen like this, one group to the right and another to the left, the group on the left will hear this, "Go damned to eternal fire. You won't be there." But the group on the right will hear, "Come, blessed one, enter, yes, enter the kingdom that has been prepared for you since the foundation of the very world." On that day, that woman could have lost this blessing. When the Holy Spirit touched her, "Go, he's in the Pharisee's house, and I'm not going to enter that house. He's going to chase me away." That man is very arrogant, very radical. Pharisees were terrible, brethren. You know, they didn't care for anyone. If one of us here, foreigners, wanted to greet them, they wouldn't greet us. "I don't greet Gentiles." They didn't talk to Gentiles. They would turn their backs. And she went to his house without being invited. But by the Holy Spirit, she was. Go where the Holy Spirit invites you. Be where he is working. Brethren, God is going to change your life completely for the better. Let me pray. God, it's very beautiful and wonderful to be in your presence. God, I pray that everyone who is listening to me at this moment, in English or in any other language that this program is being broadcast, may these people hear one day that their sins have been forgiven and that they have been saved. They need to realize this so that they can be happy with your love and go in peace. Oh, my God, give me these souls, Father. God, give me each person that heard this word today. Reach out with your hands, Father. God, save all of their souls. And may each one of them become a blessing. God, we love you. The Holy Spirit that has brought us here, you want to bless each and every one of us today, Spirit of God. In the name of Jesus, thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, because this person is understanding your word, a hard heart made of stone, a heart of very hard rock. It has been dismantled now, here, at home. Oh, Father, help this person live in your hiding place. And may this person rest in your shadow. In the name of Jesus, God, thank you and amen. Oh, glory to God. Well, that was beautiful there. Thank you, Jesus. Stand strong. God has something big for you. God has called you here today to change your life. Walk firmly with Jesus. You shall never perish again. And now let's go to the real life drama for today.
Was a sponsor, even though I belonged to another denomination. During the time I was a sponsor, we had a very stable life, a good financial life. Then I stopped being a sponsor, you know, because of the denomination's reasons. And unfortunately, was not a good choice. During this time, our financial situation, you know, declined. We lost a property of 180,000 reais. I was very stressed, so I went into depression. It was a really deep one.
She would cry a lot, didn't go out of the house. Very, very, very sad. She didn't even chat with us anymore.
And that pain, that sadness, and that distress, it seemed that it would never end. I felt as if my heart was going to explode because I was so sad.
I felt sad because I didn't know what was happening with her.
While at home, Lydia starts to have some signs of happiness watching the Faith Show in the middle of 2012. She was living in Curitiba when she felt another special call.
I didn't go to church for a long time. We couldn't find a proper place, you know, where we could worship the Lord according to what is written in His Word, right? True adorers. And then the Lord touched me again with regards to the sponsorship. Look for the place where you used to be a sponsor. And it was to that church that the Lord God took me on a Wednesday. You know, I was 1 hour late because I didn't have a clue about the schedule of the services. I was very warmly welcomed by the pastor, very well supported, as until now. So we started, you know. To go there, we started the sponsorship right away, and the blessing came to Camilla's life. And so I wrote my name, and beside it, I wrote - Dr. Camilla. You know, and God honored her life. Within a month, she had been approved in 3 universities for medicine. So this is God's pampering for when we obey. You know, when He said, be a sponsor, and I did it, and God honored us.
I applied for 5 universities. In 2 of them, I was on the waiting list for medicine, and in the other 2, I was approved for biomedicine. I thank God, because the day I saw that I had been approved, right, we kneeled down and started praying, because I thought it would not be possible.
I was healed from the depression without taking any medication. I was able to stand up and be like I was before, a happy and joyful woman.
I thank God for her to be the person she is today. She's no longer sad, and she's everything to me, my mom.
My heart is very happy today.
Today, Lydia and her daughter have the prosperity they used to have when they first started to sponsor.
I seek, you know, to eat from the best in this world. And He assures us this. We're moving to a place closer to the university and certainly a better place that God is preparing for us. We're very happy because we're members of the Grace of God Church.
That's wonderful. Let's give Jesus a round of applause. And now let's go to the question and answer segment for today.
Doctor, how can we help someone that is narrow-minded and that can't understand God's things?
You have to ask God for wisdom, because even people with difficult reasoning, I've even seen people that were considered mentally impaired, but they were healed watching the Faith Show And even his mother couldn't believe it when she saw her son standing up. She had never seen that before. He would slobber, and before she knew it, she was observing him like this. She couldn't believe her eyes. I said, come up here, pray with me. And she said, Dr. Suarez, he stood up and put his hand with yours. I couldn't believe that. And this young man left completely healed. So we have to ask for wisdom from God, because with his wisdom, everybody can understand. And now for the second question.
Dr. Suarez, why is it in the parable of the seed, does it say that some will not be saved?
Well, he didn't exactly say that. He said that the seed was sowed, the parable of the seed. And when he threw some of the seeds, a part of them, and this is called throwing sowing, that was used frequently at that time, some fell on the roadside. And there in the roadside, they were trodden on. And also the birds came and ate them, so it was useless. Another part fell into rocky soil. It was very rocky. And because there wasn't a lot of soil, the tribulation came. This means the people, the first ones who are the ones who receive with joy and give up. And the rocky soil is when tribulation comes, like the sun, that heats up the ground when there is not enough soil, so it burns the seeds and they don't grow. So it talks about those who are afraid of the tribulations and go away. And when it talks about the third group of people, that is the one where the seed fell among thorns. And if you've been to the countryside where there are thorns, nothing grows. You have to remove the thorns, fertilize it, because the thorns block the rays of the sun, and then nothing can grow there. And when it grew, it couldn't produce anything. And Jesus interpreted the thorns, saying that they are the cares of life, the fascination for wealth, and ambition for other things. These issues block growth of the Word of God. Then he said that part fell in good soil. This produced some 100-fold, some 60, some 30, a good production. And our hearts have to be just like this. So let's prepare our hearts so that the soil is good and it can produce in a complete way. Let me pray for those who are at home, and after we'll pray for you here. God, I pray for those who are at home. The program is about to end. They've participated in a very blessed service. My soul united with the soul of these people, and I say now, all evil, take everything that is yours and go away at once. No longer oppress. Go away with all of your evil thoughts. In the name of Jesus, amen.